Once again, a very good evening to every one of you, and thanks to Retailers Association on my own behalf and on behalf of my company, Aparajita Corporate Services Limited, for the slot provided. And I think I can take 40 minutes. I think many of you may be aware that a lot of changes are happening in the labor and employment domain. I think big changes since independence. I'll try to summarize the significant changes, maybe the possible impacts within the given time. And my presentation will be in three parts broadly. Of course, I'll touch upon the background, the context, and then I'll spend some time on wages, right? Specifically, the definition for the term wage or the salary. It is defined in all the four codes, and it has a common definition, but it has implications on all the other allied legislations, whether it is PF or ESI or bonus or gratuity. So I'll just try to explain that with some examples. Then I'll move on to the codes, all the four codes. Again, the significant changes or the highlights with its possible impacts. That is how I have planned my presentation. So the rationale, yes, I have two slides to explain that. So I'll move on to the next point. Changes only in central. You all know that the subject labor as well as the social security, they fall under the concurrent list of the Indian Constitution, which means the central government as well as the various state governments will have powers to enact laws on that legislations, right? But whatever changes happening now, it is happening only in the central sphere, right? So whether the states will also follow suit or not, I think we have to wait and see. And yes, these are all central legislations which are getting subsumed into four labor codes now, but the rules, corresponding rules, are yet to be framed, right? I think the central government is working on it a bit fast. I also learned that the code on wages rules has already been released. Draft is released, but it is yet to be through. And today, I think I saw that the other rules have also been drafted and released. But of course, some debate has to happen and it is yet to be passed. Right. So and the government, the central government, is also requesting the various state governments through the labor secretaries, state labor secretaries, for framing their corresponding state rules for these codes. And finally, I think people were saying that it could come sometime in December this year, but there are also indications that it would be a reality, and it is possible that from April 2021, these codes would get implemented. So coming back to the rationale, in fact, we all know that the economic reforms happened sometime in 1991 under P.V. Narasimha Rao's government. And since then, in fact, the industries have been asking for the corresponding labor reforms, right? And I think there was not much movement at that time, but during the Vajpayee period, sometime around 2002, I think the second National Commission on Labor, it was formed, and they made a detailed study, and they made a recommendation to consolidate the existing set of labor legislations into five codes: one on industrial relations, another one on wages, the third one on social security, fourth one on safety, and the last one on welfare and working conditions. Right. So instead of five, I think the last two, safety and welfare and working conditions, that is now compressed into one, and now it is remaining as four codes. And of course, though the recommendations were made by the National Commission on Labor as early in 2002. In fact, subsequently, the political scenario changed. And I think for the next 10 to 12 years, absolutely, there was no movement on this. And again, from 2014, we have been hearing about the changes in the labor and employment domain. I think something is happening now. And really, it is going to be a major change once these proposed codes are implemented. And of course, the idea is to amalgamate, to simplify and rationalize the existing set of labor legislations, and it also should help the industries in its easy implementation. And again, there are multiple laws, multiple terminologies. I think same term is defined in almost all these legislations, and multiple authorities exercising jurisdiction over the industries. So again, the idea of these courts is to reduce these things also. Again, and the another important aspect is to leverage on the technology, right? I think that should automatically bring in a kind of transparency, accountability, consistency, uniformity in the compliance activities, and the government is also planning for giving flexibility in dynamic factors. Say, for example, the working hours. Now, if you take under the Factories Act, it is a central legislation, so the working hours are clearly fixed now, right? So, and it is applicable across industry, I mean across the country, across all the industries. So if it is 9 hours, means it cannot go beyond 9 hours across the country. But now I think the central government is proposing to give powers to the state governments also. So like this, there are several other dynamic factors for which the powers are given to central state governments. For being appropriate governments, they can also come up with notifications on this. And of course, ideally, it should the reforms or changes, whatever it is, it should help in setting up of more enterprises, and that should as a consequence, that should create a lot of employment opportunities. So rather than looking at from any particular stakeholder's perspective, it should be based on the business and the employment opportunities. And finally, I think the penalty imposed, it is getting increased like anything, right? But on the other side, the compounding of offense is also, that provision is also extended to the employers, which means suppose if the maximum punishment is, say, 10,000 rupees, then an officer will be appointed for that specific purpose. The employer can approach that officer and paying 50% of the amount immediately, they can come out of that. But that is only for the first time, right? So subsequent time, it is not possible, right? But it is an advantage to the employers for the first time. Yeah, and I'm sure that you will all be hearing about that. There are 44 central legislations which are getting subsumed into four courts now. And I just made a little search. To my knowledge, I think the list comes to 47. Out of the total 47, maybe I would like to draw your attention to the serial from serial number 37 to 47, plus around 11 legislations which are in red font. I think these 11 legislations are already repealed. So currently there are only 36 legislations, right? So out of these 36, yeah, this 29, whatever you are seeing in our screen, I think these 29 are getting subsumed into four courts, right? The Code on Wages, the Code on Social Security, Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code, and the Industry Relations Code. These are all the four courts, right? So these are all the 29 legislations, not exactly the 44, right? So the number is currently 36 only. So 29 are getting subsumed. So remaining seven is there. Out of the seven, POSH Act is one. Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act is one, right? So these seven legislations will operate simultaneously along with these four courts. That is how it should be. Again, move on. So what is the status of these courts? Of course, Code on Wages, it was passed in the Lok Sabha, in the Rajya Sabha, and it also got the president assent last year itself, in August 2019 itself. With respect to the other three courts, Occupational Safety, Industrial Relations, and Social Security, it was passed last month, September 2020. So this is the status. As I said in the beginning, the central rules under these courts are awaited, as well as the state rules. So only when the rules are framed and it also gets implemented, only then I think it will be wholesome. Only then it will be easy for the employers to get into implementation. So it is likely that it could be from April 2021. Now, specific to Code on Wages. So the Minimum Wages Act, the Payment of Wages Act, the Payment of Bonus Act, the Equal Remuneration Act. These are all the four legislations related to wages now getting subsumed into one code called Code on Wages 2019. And I think starting from the Factories Act till the Cine Workers and Cinema Theatre Workers Act, there are 13 legislations you are seeing in your screen. These are all the list of 13 legislations which are now getting subsumed into one code named Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions. These are all, I think, governing legislations, in fact. So this Occupational Safety Code will have 13 legislations, existing 13 legislations. And the Code on Social Security, again, starting from Employees' Compensation, the erstwhile Workmen's Compensation Act, Employees' State Insurance Act, ESI, the Employees' Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provisions Act, PF, Employment Exchange Act, Maternity Benefit, Payment of Gratuity, Senior Workers' Welfare Fund, BOCW Act, Building and Other Construction Workers' CIS Act, and the Unorganized Workers' Social Security Act. These are all the 9 legislations now getting consolidated into one code, which is Code on Social Security. And finally, the Industrial Relations Code. I think we all know, again, the Industrial Disputes Act is considered to be the backbone of the entire set of labor legislations. It may not have a large number of compliance tasks, compliance activities for the employees, but it is very, very active legislation, right? So if something is happening, some contravention is happening in some other legislation, I think that could end up in a dispute. So that will be governed by Industrial Disputes Act. That is how it is. So I think strike, lockout, everything will be handled under this act only. So Trade Unions Act, again, another significant act, and Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act. Again, when we say standing orders, it will define the set of service conditions, uniform service conditions for the workers. All these three legislations are now getting subsumed into Industrial Relations Code. So this is how it is arranged, all the four codes. And more for the statistics purpose, maybe we will take, for example, the Code on Wages. Number of sections, right? So all the currently, I think 4 legislations are now getting subsumed into one code on wages. And the number of sections in all the 4 existing legislations, minimum wages, payment of bonus and equal remuneration, it is 115. That 115 is now coming down to 69. So the point is the number of sections is coming down. Secondly, the number of rules, right? I think currently the central rules alone I have taken, for example, which is 67, maybe put together all the 4 legislations. Now it is coming down to 58, right? So there is a draft rule already issued under Code on Wages. That number only I'm talking about, it is yet to be passed, as I said in the beginning. And the number of terminologies defined, it is 46 under 4 different legislations. Now that is coming down to 26. And the number of statutory returns to be submitted, it is 3, which is coming down to 1. And the number of statutory registers to be maintained, right, on an ongoing basis, it is 14 under all the 4 legislations. Now that is coming down to just 3. And the number of abstracts to be displayed, it is 2, and it is coming down to 1. And similarly, statutory notices, from 2, it is coming down to 1. So overall, I think you can also see in other codes also, but except in the case of IR code, right? I think I have encircled in red font. I think the number of sections, maybe put together all the 3 legislations, Standing Orders, Industrial Disputes Act, and the Trade Unions Act, it is currently 88, but that is getting increased to 104, right? I think certain new concepts are getting introduced in the IR code. That could be the reason why the number of sections is going up. Still, overall, putting together all the 4 codes, the number of sections is coming down, number of legislations is coming down, the number of compliance tasks, it is coming down. That is how, that is the idea, and that is how it is planned also. And I think this, maybe we can have it as a background. And now I'm getting into specifically for analyzing the term wage. As I said in the beginning, this term is defined in all the 4 codes separately, but the definition is common, right? I may take you through the, maybe I have extracted the definition, because I think since this is significant, because once a company has a proper salary structure in place, I would say 50 to 60% of compliance is done, right? Because this will have implication on minimum wages. This will have implication on payment of wages. This will have implication on bonus, on gratuity, on PF, on ESI, on industrial disputes, everything, right? So once the salary structure, proper salary structure is in place, I think I would definitely say 50 to 60% of compliance is done. That is the reason I think I am planning to take some time to explain how the definition, how it is getting changed, maybe comparing to how it exists currently. And it has all the 5 parts. It has substantive part, it has inclusion part, it has exclusion part, it has provisions, it has explanation. I think provision and provisos and explanation, it is there in the next slide. I explain that. And all remuneration by way of salaries, allowances, or otherwise. Again, whatever is expressed in the contract of employment, as per the terms of employment. So that will be considered as salary. We all know that. In fact, then when we say terms of employment or contract of employment, it's nothing but the appointment order. So whatever is getting mentioned in the appointment order, that will be treated as salary or wage, unless and otherwise the contrary is proved by the employer. Right. So the assumption, the presumption would be whatever is mentioned in the contract of employment, it will be considered as wage. And specifically, it includes basic DNS allowance and retaining allowance. That is the second part. When we say retaining allowance, it will be more applicable for seasonal industries because during the non-seasonal period, in fact, they would like to retain the workers. So during that period, I think they would continue to pay some amount to those workers. That is called retaining allowance. That may not be applicable to all the industries. That is the reason, in fact, many of the perennial industry may not have this component. And exclusion part, I think it is running from class A to class K, which you can see in our screens. And of these 11 classes, right, again, B, F, G, and H, four classes, again, it is given in the red font. These are all excluded only for the purposes of minimum wages and bonus, right? But this will be considered as wages for the purposes of payment of wages as well as equal remuneration. That is the reason I have highlighted that in red font. And apart from that, if you look at class A, I think I have again put it in the bold letters, any bonus payable under any law and any contribution paid by the employer to any pension fund or provident funds. And G is remuneration payable under any award or settlement. Because I think there is a little bit of confusion, which I feel. When we say remuneration payable under any award or settlement, a settlement is happening between managements and unions. In fact, once in 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, not more than 5 years. It will not go beyond 5 years, right? But I'm not very sure why that is getting excluded here, right? I tried to understand that, but I did not get any specific answer. So I think somewhere that seems to be a gray area, right? But somehow the definition is like this only. So class A, it is in the exclusion part. Class C is in the exclusion part. Then class G is in the exclusion part. Let me now move on to the next slide. Then if required, I'll come back here. So I think this is very crucial now. I think this is going to be the significant change because I think, again, the underlined portion, highlighted portion, if payments made by the employer to the employee under classes A to I exceeds 1/2. So when they say classes A to I, it is in the excluded part, right? But they have left out J and K. J and K is, I'll again go back, J and K is gratuity and retrenchment compensation. So it is very clearly excluded. Absolutely no issues with respect to these two components, right? But A to I, if we add up A to I, and if that goes beyond 50% of the total remuneration, then the excess amount will automatically be deemed as salary or wage. That is the, I think, this the new definition says. So again, significantly, a cap is brought in for the excluded components alone. Now, I think we all know, even assuming that if a person is drawing 50,000 as salary per month, right? Maybe only basic will amount to say 10,000. Rest of the 40,000, I think it will be allowance 1, allowance 2, allowance 3, allowance 4, each 10,000. So when we say allowance, it is getting excluded for the purpose of any legislation. Currently, I'm saying, right? So only we will consider only 10,000 basic for the purpose of PF, or for calculating bonus, or for calculating gratuity. So out of the 50,000, 10,000 means it works out to only 20%. So that is the reason, in fact, the government is now coming up with a cap for the excluded components alone. So whatever components we have, I think we can derive or finalize the structure for our company based on our nature of industry, as well as the nature of work done by the particular individual. We can, the managements have rights to finalize or fix the salary structure. But point here is the salary, the excluded components cannot go beyond 50%, right? So I think that is the catch. And that is a significant change. And that has implication also. Now, we have two terminologies. So in a particular salary structure, what is the quantum of wage? That is to be very clearly arrived at. So for arriving at the quantum of wages, we need to know the quantum of total remuneration in the first place. Right? As I said, as the definition says, when we say remuneration, it is equivalent to the substantive part on and the components in mentioned in the inclusion part and the components mentioned in the exclusion part. All the three put together, three parts put together, it is considered as remuneration, except J and K, that is gratuity and retrenchment compensation. Now, from once we arrive at the figure for remuneration, then wages means remuneration minus the sum of clauses mentioned in the exclusion part from A to I. That is how it says, right? And A to I includes bonus. But bonus is an annual payment. I wonder why it is getting included here. Similarly, employer's contribution towards PF. I think that is not really income which a worker or an employee is getting on a monthly basis directly from the employer. But again, I'm not very sure why it is getting included here. Right? I'll try to explain this with an example in the subsequent slide. No, so this is the simple salary structure. Assume that a particular person has a salary of with five components, basic DNS allowance, house rent allowance, HREA, conveyance allowance and commission. Right. So out of this, in fact, the total monthly gross comes to 13,000 in the example I have given, which you can see in your screens, 5,000, 2,000, 2,000, 2,000 plus 2,000. Right, the monthly gross payment, gross one, so it comes to 13,000, and the employer's contribution towards PF, it is 840, and employer's contribution towards ESI, it is 228, and bonus, if it is reckoned for the month, maybe the maximum bonus of 20%, it comes to 1,400, right? Now, I think we have another figure, 15,468, which I have mentioned as gross two. It is again just an example only. Now, the question is, please come to the right side part. What is the total remuneration? Is it gross one or gross two? I would say ideally, it should be gross one, right? It cannot be gross two because gross two means it contains employer's contribution towards PF and the bonus, which is an annual payment. Right. So if it is also treated as wages, then I think again, we cannot calculate PF contributions on this amount. I think so ideally it should be gross one, but I think some clarity or guidelines should be issued by the authority concerned or the government by notification before the code gets implemented. Otherwise, I think employers will find it difficult to go ahead. Right. Again, assuming that gross one is the total remuneration. Right, in which case then the total sum is 13,000. Gross one is 13,000. And 50% of 13,000 works out to 6,500. Right, and basic and DA alone, basic and DA alone is 7,000, which is more than 50%. So excluded components, sum of to excluded components, it is less than 50%. Right, so I would say in this given example, if the monthly gross is considered as total remuneration, this salary structuring is proper in accordance with the new definition. On the other hand, maybe if you take the gross two as the total remuneration, when we say gross two, I think we may have to exclude the employer's contribution towards ESI because that is not getting mentioned anywhere in the clauses A to K. It is mentioned, it is not mentioned there, but employer's contribution towards PF is mentioned. So I have taken that into. So, gross two means, which is 15,240, right? So 50% works out to 7,620. Basic and DA alone comes to 7,000, which is less than 50%, which means the sum of the excluded components, that is HREA, conveyance allowance, commission, those are all excluded components as per the new definition. So the sum of the total excluded components alone, it is more than 50% by 620 rupees. So automatically, this 620 rupees will be treated as wages, along with the 7,000, which is basic plus DA, right? So 7,620 will automatically be considered as wages. So as per the new definition, this is how it can work out, right? So maybe you may have some structure existing in your company. Please you may have to check with the new definition now. But one thing is how to calculate remuneration, whether it is gross one or gross two in the given example. That clarification is required. Otherwise, it will be difficult for the employers to go ahead. And specifically with respect to minimum wages. Now, I think we have the tendency to split minimum wages, even if mere minimum rates of wages is paid, particularly with respect to contract workers. Many of the industries are paying merely the minimum rates of wages, not single pay extra, right? So again, I've given one example, basic DA and HRA, and total comes to 12,000. Assuming that minimum wages in this case is 10,000 for that person, the applicable amount is 10,000. As per the current provisions of the present Minimum Wages Act, right? So the wages, we would consider it as 12,000 because the entire gross would be treated as wages. So it is 12,000 because HRA is included, is considered as wages as per the definition of the term wage under the Minimum Wages Act. So we will take into account HRA also. So the total wages comes to 12,000. So which is more than 10,000. So this is in order. But if you apply the new definition, right, then HRA is excluded. It is not included in the definition. It is in the excluded portion, which means balance amount is only 9,000, which is less than 10,000. So in the given example, this is not complying with the minimum wages provision. So there is a shortage of 1,000 rupees, right? Maybe I'll move on for other things also. Now it is bonus, right? Bonus again, basic 10,000. DA 4,000 and HRA, conveyance allowance and commission each 5,000. So total comes to 29,000. So currently we will take into account only basic and DA for calculating bonus, which is 14,000, 10,000 plus 4,000. But 50%, assuming that the monthly gross is considered to be the total remuneration, the 50% works out to 14,500. So automatically it will be deemed that 14,500 would be the wages for the purpose of bonus, and bonus is to be calculated for that, right? But of course, currently there is a ceiling. If a person is drawing less than 21,000, then he is entitled for payment of bonus. But for calculation purpose, it can be restricted to 7,000 or the minimum rates of wages, whichever is higher, right? So that is but the wages would be treated as 14,500 for the purpose of bonus, not 14,000 like we do now. Similarly, PF, basic, DA, 12,000, 4,000, and HRA, conveyance and commission, each 6,000. Total comes to 34,000. Basic and DA alone works out to 16,000, which is less than 17,000, which is the 50% of the monthly gross. So this will not be accepted as right salary structure for the purposes of PF, right? So it will be automatically deemed as 17,000 PF wages. Of course, if there is a ceiling, currently we know there is a ceiling that the employers can restrict the contributions to 15,000. If that ceiling continues, then of course here also in this example also, we can restrict the contributions to 15,000. Otherwise, calculation is to be made for entire 17,000 and it is not for 16,000 as we do now. And ESI, again, basic, DA and HRA, total 24,000. So entire monthly gross wage will be treated as wage for the purpose of ESI currently as per section 222 of the ESI Act. And this is more than 21,000. So this person will go out of the purview of ESI. So he will not be covered. So no contribution is required. But whereas HRA is now, as per the new definition, it is getting excluded. So for the purpose of ESI, the balance will be only 18,000, which is less than 21,000. So the individual is to be covered under ESI. So contributions ought to be made. So the position is getting changed because of the new definition for the purpose of ESI. Then gratuity, again, we will consider only basic and DA currently, which means in this example, 12,000 plus 4,000. That alone we will consider. But the monthly gross comes to 34,000. So 50% of that is working out to 17,000. So as per the new definition, we may have to calculate gratuity on 17,000, not on 16,000, right? So I think I've just come up with some examples for all these cases because these are all very significant. One change that is capping the total sum of excluded components, that brings out a lot of implications on various aspects. I think that is the reason I just thought this would be important to explain. That is the reason I took some time on this. And specifically other aspects, a cap is fixed now for the excluded components. And gratuity is very clearly excluded. I think the class J, right? It is gratuity. It is very clearly excluded. If you go through the definition of the term wages under the payment of wages currently, that also has inclusion part as well as exclusion part. In both the parts, gratuity is mentioned, right? So the Madras High Court, in one of its decisions, in I think if I'm right, it is the Madras Fertilizers case. They said gratuity is to be considered to have been included in the inclusion part. So, which means gratuity is wages. That is the reason, in fact, as far as since the decision is by Madras High Court, this will have binding effect on the establishments operating in Tamil Nadu, right? So that will be treated as wages because they said gratuity is falling under the inclusion part, under the current definition, under the present Payment of Wages Act. That is the reason, in fact, if the contractor fails to pay the gratuity to his workers, the liability goes on to, passes on to the principal employer. But this situation is prevalent only in Tamil Nadu, right? Because the other high courts, they have contra judgments, right? So, but as per the new definition for the term wages, I think it is very clearly excluded, right? So it will not be treated as wages at all, gratuity payment. So once this is implemented, the decision given by the Honorable Madras High Court in Madras Fertilizers case will automatically get nullified. It will no more be valid. And 50% of the wages shall be equivalent to or more than the wages. Assuming after implementation, a company is availing maximum exclusion, that is 50%. Then only the balance 50% will be considered as wages. Then we should ensure that the balance 50% is equivalent to or more than the minimum rates of wages applicable to that person, right? But currently, that is not the situation. Currently, the monthly gross should be equivalent to or more than the minimum wages. That is considered sufficient compliance. So there is again a change. Then wages for maternity benefits, when we calculate maternity benefits, the entire gross wage will be taken into account. Now, we can go for 50%. So in that sense, for the purpose of maternity benefits, the financial commitment can come down. Similarly, with respect to employees' compensation, if in case of employment injury, if any compensation is to be paid, then the monthly gross is now taken into account. Of course, subject to ceiling, which is currently 15,000, right? But after the implementation of this code, I think it is sufficient if we consider only 50%, not necessarily the entire gross wage. And floor wage and minimum wage, there are two concepts now. So the minimum wages, the appropriate governments will continue to fix the minimum rates of wages, be it central government or various state governments, right? But there is going to be another concept, which is floor wage. Floor wage will be fixed only by the central government, right? And the minimum wages fixed by the appropriate governments cannot go below floor wage, right? So I think we may have to very carefully watch both the notifications under for the purpose of floor wage as well as for the purpose of minimum wage. Only then we can finalize the salary structure for a person, be it a regular employee or the contract worker. And the full and final settlement, yes, of course, we are doing the full and final, or we are supposed to do the full and final settlement within 2 working days, even today, once the services of a person are terminated, right? But this is not applicable for the resignation cases. So only if the termination happens is done by the employer, only then I think this will be applicable. But for resignation, this will not be applicable. But as per the court, in case of resignation also, the full and final settlement is to be made within next 2 working days from the actual date of termination. And the monthly wages, yes, we are paying monthly wages, but we can pay either before 7th of the subsequent month or before 10th, right? If an industrial establishment has more than 1,000 workers, then they can pay before 10th. If they have only less than 1,000, then it should be paid before 7th day of the subsequent month. That is how we go. But now I think there is only one option. In any case, it should be paid before 7th. So 10 days timeline is no more available. Then contractors payment. See, a lot of, I think today, most of the contractors themselves are legal entities. So actually they do not wait for receiving their consideration, monthly consideration from the principal employer to make the payment of wages to their workers in turn, right? They are not waiting for payment from the principal employer. But actually, the idea of contractor, engagement of contractor, as per that, in fact, the payment is to be made by the principal employer to the contractor, and he in turn has to pay the wages to his workers only out of the consideration he received from the principal employer. I think now that is getting insisted very clearly. Contractor's payment shall be ensured by company before the contractor makes the payment of wages to his employees or workers, right? Again, going to be a statutory mandate. And specifically with respect to wages, minimum wages will be applicable. I think now there is a schedule attached to the Minimum Wages Act. So only those industries which are mentioned under the schedule, for them only minimum rates of wages will be applicable. But now, as per the court, it will be applicable to all the industries as well as to all the employees, right? That is number one. Number two, there is a ceiling of 24,000. If a person, employee, is drawing more than 24,000, he will not fall under the purview of the Payment of Wages Act, right? But that ceiling is now removed as per the court. So irrespective of the quantum of salary one person is drawing, he will come under the purview of the provisions of the Payment of Wages Act. Again, full and final settlement, I think we discussed on that. It should be done within 2 days, even for resignation cases. And monthly wages is to be paid within 7 days, irrespective of the number of employees, whether it is 1,000 or less than 1,000 or more than 1,000. And the bonus, I think interestingly, if there are 20 or more employees, then the Payment of Bonus Act will be applicable. Currently, I'm saying. And subsequently, if the number falls below the threshold limit, then also the Act will continue to apply. Right. But in the code, it says that in every accounting year, that minimum number should have been employed. Right. So if we go through, and there is no specific mention about the continuous applicability, even if this threshold limit falls below that, like we have in the current legislation. So if we strictly apply the wordings mentioned in the applicability part of bonus, I think for every year, we may have to check whether the Bonus Act will be applicable. So it could be like 2-3 years, we will be paying because it is applicable. Fourth year, if we do not engage even for a single day in the entire accounting year, the minimum number of employees, that is 20, then I think we need not pay bonus for the fourth year. That is how it appears. But I think, I don't think that would be the intention. There is that should be some error. Again, that should be corrected. Otherwise, it will be difficult for the employers to understand that. Then salary ceiling, we all know there is a salary ceiling for bonus for eligibility, which is 21,000. For calculation also, which is 7,000 or minimum rates of wages, whichever is higher, right? But that is fixed by the central government and it is common across India, right? But now the powers are given to the appropriate governments. So state governments will now fix the salary ceiling both for eligibility and for calculation. So it could vary. It may not be uniform once the code gets implemented. Then contractors' payment, we discussed on that. It should be paid by the principal employer in the first place. Only then the contractor has to pay out of the consideration received the wages to his workers. Now, I think OSHWC, it is Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code, specifically with respect to contract labor. Again, now we all know that if there are 20 or more contract workers, only then the Act will be applicable. Contract Labor Regulation and Abolition Act will be applicable to the establishment. Similarly, a contractor who engages 20 or more workers, only for him the Act will be applicable. But that number, threshold limit 20, is getting increased to 50. I think it is a kind of a relief to the employers. Then the contract labor definition, again, it excludes persons specifically who are regularly employed by the contractor. Now, since, as I said in the beginning, most of the contractors themselves are legal entities and they have their own employees and they are utilizing the services of their own employees for carrying out the obligations arising out of the contract which he entered into with the principal employer, right? But the regular employees of the contractor will no more be considered as contract workers at all. I think, again, this could favor the principal employer because the number of contract workers can come down, right? Most of the cases, it is particularly with respect to, I would say, the security agencies. So they are all the regular employees of these security agencies, right? So they are not specifically taken recruited for any particular company's purpose, right? So I think they may go out of the purview of being called as contract labor once the code is through. The term core activity is defined. I think currently it is not defined except in Andhra Pradesh, right? But now I think they are bringing in a definition for the term core activity, and the employers are not supposed to engage contract labor in core activity. And if it is done, then that will be considered as sham arrangement. And the contractors, if they have operations in multiple states, they can have one common license. But I'm not very sure how feasible it is, but they are bringing in a class like that. Then the contract labor chapter, if you go through the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code, I think it is made applicable only to manpower supply contractor. Again, I'm not very sure something is missed out or is it intentional, because if you go through the definition of the term contractor in the section two, which is the definition section, there they have mentioned both the contractors, job contractors as well as manpower supply contractors. Similarly, under section 47, which discusses about the contractor's license, it also mentions that license is to be obtained by both job contractor as well as manpower supply contractor. But only in the applicability part, they have mentioned that it is applicable only to manpower supply contractors. I'm not, again, very sure. I think it should be an error. And direct liability of principal employer. Currently, we know as per section 16 of the current Contract Labor Act, the amenities are to be provided by the contractors, starting from providing drinking water to the contract workers, right, or washrooms, whatever it is. But if he is not providing, then the liability will go to the principal employer. But now, I think liability is directly latched on the principal employer as per the code. And this is, I think, same code, but this is very specific to interstate migrant workers. I think out of the experience we received during these 7 months because of the pandemic, I think if there are 10 or more interstate migrant workers, only then this will be applicable to an establishment. That is number one. And in case if there is a serious bodily injury or death happens, then that should be reported to the authorities in both the places, in the destination state as well as in the home state of the interstate migrant worker, as well as to his kith and kin, right? So the employer must have data related to interstate migrant worker, right? And more importantly, it is not necessarily that those who are engaged through a contractor alone be treated as interstate migrant worker. I think even if the persons are engaged directly by the employer, they will also be treated as interstate migrant worker. That is a change, in fact. And they should be provided with a toll-free helpline. And of course, the appropriate governments have to come up with provisions for that. Then also, there must be a provision for the interstate migrant workers to pursue their studies. I think, again, the liability is on the appropriate government to come up with, to frame rules for that. And specific to factories, I think we all know if the premises will be considered as a factory if some manufacturing process is carried out. If the manufacturing process is carried out with the aid of power, right, then the minimum number required is 10 workers. If it is not carried out with the aid of power, then the minimum number required is 20. So instead of 10 and 20, now that is getting increased to 20 and 40. Again, this should ideally help, again, the small sector companies, particularly in the MSMEs and the night shift for women with her concern. I think it is now possible. Under Factories Act, there is a bar to engage women employees beyond 7 p.m., right, till 6 a.m. in the morning next day, right? But of course, with special permission, it is possible. But Madras High Court alone in R. Vasanta's case said that this particular section is unconstitutional. So they struck down this particular section, but it is applicable again only for establishments or factories in Tamil Nadu. They can, even today, they can engage during the night time. But of course, they may have to follow all the precautionary measures. But now, I think that the women employees can be engaged during the night time, but of course, only with the consent of the women workers. Similarly, asking the workers to work overtime, the consent of the workers is to be obtained. And we all know that one of the directors should be nominated, directors in the board, he should be nominated as an occupier, and his name is to be intimated to the authority concerned, right? But the independent directors, their names, they cannot be nominated and their names cannot be communicated to the authorities. I think there is a burnout, but that is a new rule. And there is a reduction in threshold limit. I think safety officer, if a factory has 1,000 or more workers, then they should appoint a safety officer, one safety officer. The 1,000 is coming down to 500. Similarly, welfare officer, if there are 500 or more workers, then the factory should have one welfare officer. That 500 is coming down to 250. Similarly, canteen, if there are 250 or more workers, the factory should have a canteen, right? That 250 is coming down to 100. So again, the threshold limit is coming down. So maybe the liability for the occupier or the owner of the factory can go up. And in case of workers, currently if a worker is working for 240 days in a continuous period of 12 months, then he becomes entitled for leave at the rate of 1 day for every 20 days of work, days worked, right? Which he can avail in the subsequent year, right? But instead of 240, now it is sufficient if the person works for 180 days to become entitled for leave, right? I think again, this is new. This could go in favor of the workers. And the other points, the appointment order is made now mandatory. Currently, it is not so. I think except some of the state-specific shops and establishments act, which mandate employers to issue appointment order, like Karnataka or Andhra Pradesh. I think not many of the states have this provision, neither the factories act or any other legislation for that matter. But that is now made mandatory. And third-party audit. Third-party means the experts. I think there will be a panel formed by the central government, and they will be always available to do the compliance, I mean, audit under the compliance, right? The startup companies and the class of establishments which would be notified by the appropriate governments in due course, they may have to do the audit with the support of, they can choose their auditors, right? There will be a panel. From out of the panel, they can choose anyone. So they can do the, they can get the audit done for their establishment. The report will be submitted only to the establishment and to the inspector having jurisdiction over that establishment. Again, it is more for development purpose. And the concept of common registration, single registration, it is coming up. If you take occupational safety, I think there are 13 legislations. Of the 13, currently, under six legislations, we need to do six different registrations. Right. So now it is going to be a common registration. It is sufficient if the establishment has one registration. Similarly, the daily hours, weekly hours, and the overtime other hours and rest interval, all those things, it can now be decided by the appropriate governments, except one thing, the daily hours cannot go beyond 8 hours. I think that is, again, a cap is fixed by the central government. And there is the definition for the term establishment. It is widened. If the establishment has 10 or more employees, then that will be treated as an establishment and the registration is to be done. And appropriate government, now a common definition is given, right? Out of the 13 legislations, now four legislations have four different definitions. Now that is made as single. And the role of inspector is getting changed. Instead of inspector, he will be termed as inspector cum facilitator. So he will first give advice and he will apprise the employers as well as the workers as to the compliance and significance of compliance. Only then he will move on to maybe taking action in case of any contravention or non-compliance. And of course, in case of factory, the facilities are to be provided for transgenders exclusively, like we do for women workers now. And I think social security. I think currently we have a wage ceiling for PF, which is 15,000. But it appears if we go through the section 226 of the code, which defines the term employee, that wage ceiling will not be available for PF purpose. It will be available for employees pension scheme. It will be available for employees deposit linked insurance scheme, EDLI. But it may not be available for PF. It appears so, but of course, we may have to wait for the schemes to be framed. But till such time, new scheme is framed. I think the existing one will be applicable, continue to be applicable. So in the existing scheme, that ceiling is there. So we can continue to have that, but we may have to wait for the new schemes to be announced. And employees, if they are if some ceiling is fixed, right, then irrespective of whether the employees are drawing salary below the ceiling fixed or above the ceiling fixed, all those employees will be taken into account to determine the applicability of either ESI or PF for the establishment. So sometimes we will get confused whether we may have to take into account only the coverable employees or should we include non-coverable employees also. Now it is very clear, both coverable and non-coverable, all those headcounts ought to be taken into account for determining the applicability. And again, the term employee very specifically excludes apprentices engaged under Apprentices Act. But this gives rise to an inference whether the other apprentices, if they are, see, suppose if an apprentice is engaged under a standing orders, right, or under the policy of the company, whether they would be treated as employees. I think, again, as per the provisions in the code, it appears so. Again, we may have to wait for the scheme, which can come up with different things. And voluntary coverage currently is available only for PF, but now it is getting extended to ESA also. So the threshold limit for applicability of ESA is going to be 10, right? But even if there are less than 10 employees, but if more than 50% of the existing employees are agreeing and the management is also agreeing, they can go in for voluntary coverage. That is possible. And voluntary coverage is possible for plantations and mines also. It is getting extended. And in case of the establishments carrying out hazardous or life-threatening activities, then I think even if the establishment has single employee, ESA can be extended, right? I think that is the power lies with the central government. And fixed term workers, now I think permission is given. The term is defined under Code on Social Security as well as Code on Industrial Relations. So they can be engaged, but they are to be treated on par with the permanent employees and they will be entitled for all the benefits available for the permanent employees, but on proportionate basis. If they are working, say, if they are giving service, say, only for 3 years, then I think gratuity is to be calculated for 3 years and it is to be paid. So proportionate basis, they are entitled for all the benefits. In case of working journalists, the minimum qualifying service for gratuity is not 5 years, it is going to be 3 years. And if there are 50 or more employees in an establishment, the crutch is to be provided, right? Again, irrespective of whether the establishment is covered under ESA or not. That is number one. Number two, the Act does not say 50 or more women employees. So irrespective of whether it is women employees or men completely or men and women put together, if there are 50 or more, then crush is to be provided. And current Employment Exchange Act, if there are 25 or more employees, only then the Act will be applicable. That is now getting reduced to 20. And government is now coming up with a new idea of providing social security benefits to the workers in the unorganized sector, right? I think currently it is estimated to be 50 crore workers totally in employment in India, of which only 10% are there in the organized sector, which roughly works out to 5 crores. So the rest to 45 crores, they are not at all entitled for any social security protection, right? I think the gig workers, home-based workers, self-employed workers, wage workers, so all these platform workers, all these people will be considered as unorganized workers or workers in the unorganized sector, right? And they will also be extended these social security benefits. But how it is going to be done, I think we may have to wait for the rules and regulations for that. And now I think we have come to the final code, industrial relations. Now the mass casual leave will also be treated as strike as per the new definition. And if there is a willful go slow, that will be treated as unfair labor practice by the worker. So action can be taken against them. And in case of retrenchment and layoff, currently, I think if there are 100 or more workers, then the industrial establishment has to take permission from the government authority. So instead of 100, that is now getting increased to 300. I think this is the moot point, which is disagreed by the trade unions. And I think they have called for some strike. If I'm right, it is on November 26th. And government is also coming up with a fund called Workers Reskilling Fund. If the workers who are retrenched, right, I think they will be paid compensation at the rate of 15 days wages for every complete year of service, right? But apart from that, mere 15 days wages alone in respect of that retrenched worker will be paid by the employer to the fund, right? The idea is to reskill the retrenched worker so that his services can be utilized elsewhere. And in case of certification of standing orders under Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act, if there are 100 or more workers, then the act will be applicable. The company, the establishment has to draft standing orders and get it certified. That again, 100 is getting increased to 300. I think these are all things, certain things which will work in favor of the employers. And fixed term employment, I think we discussed on that. Trade union, again, now there is going to be a mandate on the employers to recognize the trade unions. So if there is a sole trade union, then that will be recognized. If there are multiple trade unions, then the one union which has the support of more than 51% of workers, that will be recognized. If there are multiple trade unions, but none of the trade unions has the support of 50% or more workers, then I think negotiating council will be formed by the employer at the rate of one representative for every 20% of the workers. So some maybe either recognized trade union or sole trade union or negotiating council will be there in an establishment to negotiate with the management. Now, I think it is more from the employer's perspective. Quickly, I'll wrap up. This is the final slide. Again, what could work in favor of the employers? I think the mass treating mass casual leave as strike and willful go slow as unfair labor practice. Increasing the threshold limit for factories instead of 10, 20, it is becoming 20 and 40. Similarly, contract labor, instead of 20, it is becoming 50. And retrenchment layoff, instead of 100, it is going to be 300. Standing orders act applicability, instead of 100, it is becoming 300. And allowing the employers to go for fixed term engagement. Then common definitions, I think typically wage, it has a common definition across the courts. And recognition of electronic records, I think it was not happening, particularly with respect to labor departments, right? But now it is accepted, right? Leveraging on technology, again, the process is also going to be online, right? I think it is done in PF, it is done in ESI. But it is not there in the Central Labor Department or in state labor departments. Once that is done, again, there will be transparency, there will be accountability, uniformity, consistency, and that will also have a check on undue advantage taken by any of the stakeholders. And the reduction in volume of transaction activities, the number of legislations coming down, number of sections coming down, number of registers to be maintained coming down, number of returns to be submitted coming down. So there is going to be less number of transactional activities and deemed approval provisions. If the application is made, but there is no response from the government authority, I think we may have to wait for say 45 days or 60 days as the case may be. After that, it will be considered to be approved, right? So deemed approval provision is also brought in. And the provision for compounding, though one side the penalty is increased, but the provision for compounding of offense, that will ease the process, that is also extended to the employers. On the other hand, what could work otherwise for employers? So the contribution to reskilling fund, I think that could increase the financial commitment, and the compulsory recognition of trade union, that is again, that may not work in favor of the employers, and the element of subjectivity and room for interpretation will always be there. I think that is the beauty of the subject called law, which will be applicable, equally applicable to the branch called labor laws also, but may not, if there is no proper understanding, or it may not give uniform understanding for all the employers, that could be a hurdle. And certain anomalies, as I said, application of contract labor. I think I'm not very sure why job contractors are missed out. It appears that it is made applicable only to the manpower supply contractor. Similarly, bonus. Every accounting year, we may have to check, unlike what is the position today. Right. I think then calculation of remuneration, we discussed at length regarding wages, right? Some clarity must be given, and financial commitment, because the minimum wages are going up, the wage definition is redefined, and the crutch is to be provided once the establishment has 50 or more employees, and obligation towards contract workers, because all the amenities now, the liability is slashed on the principal employer, and the increased penalty we discussed, and separate amenities for transgenders, and social security for unorganized workers. I think all these could increase the financial commitment for an employer. And I think we have come to the end. Once again, on my own behalf and on behalf of my company, Aparajita, I thank Retailers Association for the opportunity given. Now it is over to you, Bhumika.